Welcome back to the channel, guys. So we're here with part two of the collection video. For those of you that missed last week's episode, this is a series documenting my collection. It's over 20 years of collecting. I hope you guys enjoy it. So the way this is gonna work, we're gonna go through the bins. I'm gonna explain a little bit about each shoe and then we'll move on. We'll do this about 500 plus times and hopefully it'll give you your fix. For those of you that are new, this is Vintage Kicks Gallery. All right, let's get started with hype meets classic, and that is the Air Yeezy 1 in the Net colorway. So I believe Zen was first, then they did Net and Blink, and those were the three colorways that we saw the Yeezy 1. Now, Nike Air Yeezy. I know a lot of you are probably saying, what? Yeezy, isn't that Adidas? Well, before Adidas, Ye was with Nike. And in fact, he was also with A Bathing Ape, he did Louis Vuitton, but that's for another video. All right, so this is definitely a love it or hate it shoe, and here's why. It's extreme, there's no getting around it. Okay, so these are basically a, we'll put it like this, they are the outfit. They don't make an outfit, they don't break an outfit, they are everything you need. And I absolutely love these, but most people that are new to sneakers just won't understand it. That's fine, I get it, they are extreme. Let's talk about some of the hidden features on this that you may not know about. Number one, the outsole, as well as the check, they glow in the dark. That's right, glow in the dark with Yeezy, that goes hand in hand, but how dope is that? Number two, the interior is two different shades of pink. So a lot of people think that's faded and that it's originally the tongue color. That's not true. This is the way they should look. In fact, that pink shade with this tan, you guys know how I feel about those linen Air Force Ones. One of my favorite color combinations of all time. This suede, this is supposed to have the Y print. If you look really close, you can see this is very faint, but it does. It's embossed in the suede. How dope is that? Y for Yeezy. You have the Y on the lace lock here, all those little hidden details. And let's not forget to mention Yeezy embroidered on the pull tab. So this was an actual signature shoe. He made his own. I love it. The sole for these is actually, might look like a Jordan 3, but it's from the Air Revolution. These have, we'll call them a Frankenstein creation, but I'm okay with it because it works. These now sell for $1,000, $1,500 all day long, sometimes even higher than that in the different colorways. And here's what I have to warn you about them. They're 10 years old at this point, guys. The midsoles are weak. When I say they're weak, I mean they're really weak. And it's not as easy as swapping a sole from a Jordan 3. Like I said, it's an Air Revolution midsole, and it's not just any Air Revolution, there's very few that actually fit this. So if you buy the wrong year, you are out of luck. On top of that, this suede, as I said, it loses that Y print. We're actually gonna do a restoration video on how to fix that. All of that being said, one of my favorite shoes of all time. I know a lot of you are leaving the channel, you're saying this guy's on crack, but just hear me out. This shoe, when it came out, set a tone. This was not Yeezy as we know Yeezy today. He was very, very popular, but he was a producer. He was not the Kim Kardashian's Yeezy. This is somebody different. This was Kanye West. And when he dropped these, this was like, I mean, it just hits you in the face. Nothing looked like this. And really, they were so limited, so expensive, that not a lot of people really jumped on the train in the beginning. Fast forward, once we got up to Air Yeezy 2, everybody was on board by then. But this was prior to that. You know how I like stuff that was the rage before the rage? Well, there you go. All right, let's move on. All right, moving right along, we have a 1999 Dunk Kentucky. This is great because it's a remake of 1985, my favorite year in sneakers. But let's talk about this particular release. Incredibly difficult to find now. When I was doing the research, putting together the cards, you know, those info cards that tell you what the shoe is that you've all been seeing, couldn't even find this. GOAT did have it after I back searched the item number on here, and they had one pair available. You already know the price, you've already seen it, but $1,600, that's insane, absolutely insane. If you spend $1,600 on this shoe and you have less than $4.8 billion in the bank account, please check yourself in somewhere. We'll get you help. Just message me, I'll get you help, I promise. But that's the crazy nature of the game we're in now. You have people legitimately thinking that a shoe like this is worth $1,600. Let's be honest here, $600, we'd be having the same conversation on this. But let's talk about if you are that crazy, you are in the market, what you have to look for when shopping for these. Number one, the soles. They harden for this year. No way around it, dead stock or used, they're gonna harden, all right? That's your first problem. Number two, see these checks? The finish on them loves to flake. Again, dead stock or used, doesn't really matter. If you wear that shoe, it's gonna flake. So consider that price, the $1,600, a single wear price. How does that feel? Yeah, all right, absolutely nuts. Let's get rid of these. They really just make me nuts. But by the way, these are for a future restoration. I know we've already done some 99s, but these are begging for my treatment. Uh-oh, sound the alarm, GR alert. All right, guys, GRs can be dope. We said it on the first episode. Still stands true today. It'll stay true for, you know, all of time. But New Balance in general, 574s are the everyman shoe, the everyday man shoe. So these particular ones came from Joe's New Balance outfit, Joe's New Balance outlet, and believe it or not, they were like $35. So if you're not familiar with Joe's New Balance outlet, not the flashiest of websites, kind of looks a little sketch, but trust me, you want to visit it because there's some really, really good deals. So these are from there. They came out in 2014. And again, $35. How can you possibly pass a shoe in this colorway for $35? I know I can't. I didn't. I bought a bunch of them. We'll see a lot of these 574s in various colorways. Some of my favorite shoes to just throw on and beat the hell out of without worrying. And can we talk about how great that blue and orange looks together? 574s. They run true to size too, by the way. Go ahead and order some, they're cheap. Well, here we are back with another Kanye West call. It's, this is more than a collaboration, it's his own shoe. And no, these aren't Roshe runs. This is the 2016 Adidas Yeezy 350 V1 Pirate Black version 2.0. So they made these in 2015 as well. They look the exact same. The only difference between those, and there is a difference in the shoe, is the heel padding. These are built up, they're a lot better to wear. So let's talk about this shoe now. Dead stock, these are gonna run you $1,000. Keep in mind, if you buy this, this shoe has a shelf life. No, the soles won't crumble, no, the soles won't harden, but they certainly do wear if you wear them around. There's no getting around it, these soles are weak. In other weaknesses, let's talk about the prime knit on these. This shoe loves to separate right where they're glued from the midsole to the upper. If you wear them enough, they're gonna do that. And then let's talk sizing, because as we know, Kanye West has a tendency of keeping us guessing with the sizing of the shoes we're ordering. This is no exception. So these run huge. So V2s, when they came out, they ran small. Now they're pretty true to size. These, when they came out, ran absolutely enormous. To complicate matters more, Kanye was telling everybody, no, order your regular size. If you order your regular size in these, they're gonna fly off your feet. They have no upper strength, no upper support. They're night and day difference than wearing a V2. But at the end of the day, they're much better looking than a V2. I know a lot of you are gonna leave right now, and I get it. But you guys gotta realize that to people that were around when these came out, we see things a little bit different. V2s to us are pretty saturated. They're pretty much a flavor of the week shoe. This has a more distinct look. You've got the Adidas logo and then YZY on the other in the suede here. They've got an incredibly complex pattern, the boost window. This is a great shoe. When these came out in 2015 in the form of Turtle Doves, I had a chance to get one retail before release even. The owner of a store called me. I said, believe me, I would love to get these. I would love to support you, but give them to somebody that really wants them. Man, do I regret that. Took me about, well, half a year to see the light. And here's the thing you have to realize about these. When they came out, the shoe market was dominated by high-top basketball shoes. Not so much after this. This started that whole wave. Kanye started that wave of runners. I know the Roshe run was a big success, and these look, well, let's be honest, they look really, really close. But these just hit different the whole way around, and these opened up the door for really hype culture to jump on and say, all right, runners are in, and that's what happened. Next, we have a 1985 Air Jordan 1 neutral gray. Just kidding, these are conventions. Same year, they look eerily similar, you know, from a distance, but they're a fraction of the price. So guys, we might have missed the boat on them because the last few pairs I saw really popped off in price, but these used to be dirt cheap. They're available in multiple colors. In fact, one of our upcoming restorations is this pair. Well, not this pair, it's the blue and white, but you get what I'm saying. They made these in 1985 and 1986, and this was the lesser expensive, more common version of the team convention. So oftentimes you see these labeled as team conventions, they're not team conventions. We'll get to a team, I don't know, three episodes down, depending on how long it takes us to get through these. But they look great, I wear them all the time. Neutral gray, natural gray, whatever you want to call it for this particular model. I believe these were actually called neutral grays, but anyway, that's for another video too. All in all, great value, great piece of history. Whether you buy an 85 or an 86, they're pretty resilient. Soles are still really good on them. They don't have air units that have crumbled. It is a great shoe. They come back to life as well. The leather, although not as good as an Air Jordan, is pretty damn good on these all the way around. They've got that signature 80s high tongue. And I mean, just take a look. If you like the Air Jordan and you don't like this, again, we'll get you checked in somewhere, I promise. Moving on to the 2013 Jordan 4 from the Fear Pack. They also did a Jordan 3 with this, maybe others. Those are the only two that I can really recall off the top of my head. But let me tell you about these. In 2013, this was one of the hottest releases of the year. And that was a year that was dominated by Jordan 3s and Jordan 4s. You had the Toros come out. You had the WC 88s come out. I'm talking some heavy hitters. You also had shoes like the Tiffany Highs. I mean, that was a really good time for sneakers. That was also the time that Nike started really playing with our emotions and giving us these random restocks, all right? It wasn't like it is now where a monitor would go off and you would run to your computer. No, no, no. Somebody would have to call you and say, hey, check Nike.com. So here's the story. I'm at lunch one day and I get a phone call. Nike just restocked everything. I said, what do you mean everything? He said, just get on there. All right, no smartphone to get on. You know, this was during the early days of internet connectivity on there, 2G. Anyway, I got back to my computer, be it 30 plus minutes later. Sure enough, most stuff was sold out. These were not. So I got them during that restock. On that restock, by the way, were the WC88s, Toros 2, the Tiffany Highs. There's a lot of heavy hitters on there, but these were actually the ones I wanted the most. So I think this is an incredible shoe. We've got the threes as well. The fours are better though, in my opinion. They've got that red air bubble, which really pops on here. Excellent quality. These break a lot of necks, and anybody that was in the game in 2013 knows how hot they were. They've got a special place in your heart, and they have Jumpman on the back. So it takes a lot for a Jumpman on the back shoe to still be relevant today. And last I checked, these still have a pretty high resale, so I guess somebody still likes them. You just don't see them often. One thing I do have to mention is I've yet to see a sole crumble on one of these too. 2013, so we're 7 years into it. That's a pretty good run for a four, in my opinion. So two thumbs up on these. If you don't have them in your collection, buy them used, get a deal, but you deserve them. All right, guys, let's talk about the HyperAdapt. Not only just the HyperAdapt, but the 1.0 and the first release at that. Believe it or not, these retailed at $729. And before you try to commit me, send me somewhere off somewhere, here's why I got these. I think they are an incredible part of sneaker history. And here's why. This was the first shoe that was mass produced, okay, from Nike with auto lacing. So you step in these, the laces tighten on their own. They're nowhere near as good as the new Adapts. They don't connect to your phone, anything like that. But at the time these came out, they were really big technology. There was such a buzz around them that you could only get them at one stop. That was in New York when they were released. They gave you a cloth bag with them, a really incredible box, which I already showed you a picture of. But at the end of the day, the technology just wasn't ready to come out to the mainstream market. So that's probably why they marked them at $729, only insane people bought them. But all in all, I'm super glad to have a pair of these in the collection. I actually have two. I have a dead stock pair and a used pair. Why? Because I think later on down the road, and you know, check in with me in 10 years and we'll see if this is true, but I think this shoe is gonna go down as an important part of Nike history. I really do. Think of what it opened the door for. Forget about the Air Mag. This is the shoe that really that technology went into. It was a complete disaster for Nike sales-wise. I mean, a flop. They're $729, let's be honest. But on top of that, they don't look like anything special. They light up when you put your foot in the beginning, but that is about it as far as the lights go on them. They're incredibly uncomfortable. They run super snug because of the electronics. They really don't have a lot going for them besides that history. So either way, love them or hate them, they're in the collection, they're here to stay, and oh, they do have lights in the back. I forgot about that. But anyway, talk to me in 10 years. We'll see if they're important. I don't know. I'm saying they are. Let's move on. Moving right along, we have a 2013 Air Max 90 Infrared. So this is the best, the undisputed. I don't care who you are. If you say otherwise, you're wrong. Everybody can have their own opinion. But to me, this is the best colorway ever for an Air Max 90. They do them every few years. They're due to re-release here in 2020, but this particular release in 2013 was the vintage model. What that meant is that it had a slightly off color upper. It had some aged looking soles. These have been soul swapped, by the way, but let's get into that in a different time as well. They had the aged tongue as well, and I love these, especially compared to the 2015 release. I think these go for $250-ish now, maybe $300, and to me, that is a deal because this is an essential part of any sneaker collection. If you're collecting sneakers and don't have an Air Max 90 Infrared, you better have good reason, or again, we're gonna have to take you somewhere. But all in all, great shoe, looks great, whether you're wearing jeans, whether you're wearing joggers, whether you're wearing shorts. It's an all-purpose hitter. Take a look at the back. I mean, come on. The sad part is, and the only knock on this shoe is we don't have an OG in the collection yet. So as soon as we have an OG, it's gonna make my appreciation grow for these even more. But until then, this is what's gonna have to suffice. Well, traveling back to 1984, how about a Nike Vandal in a super rare colorway? So guys, if you know the name of this colorway, let me know. I'm really curious because I haven't seen anybody, I mean, I would imagine it's like a UCLA or something like that, but anyway, I haven't seen anything official on what this colorway is called. I have seen this colorway in a couple other Nike models from the era, but come on, take a look at that. They just look tremendous. 1984, still wearable. The padding still plush. They are made like canvas tanks. So I highly recommend Vandals to anybody that wants to get into vintage on a budget because Vandals are still super underrated. If you can find a rare colorway like this, scoop them up, wear them, enjoy them. I love them. I found these in Japan. Want to say they were $100, could have that wrong. They might be from an overnight from Japan, I'm not sure. But if they were, go back, watch it, figure it out what I paid for them, but I know it wasn't much. I have worn these a lot, guys. I get compliments on them. What are those? In a good way. But all in all, Vandals are a go. Nike has tried retroing the Vandal a number of times, and we have some retros we'll get into, but they've never really captured the masses again. I'm really surprised. This is a shoe that was sold in 84 and 85 during the time of the Air Jordan, and they have vibes of an Air Jordan, they have vibes at the convention, they have vibes of an Air Force One. all that together, you would think would be really a slam dunk with them, but they're not. So I don't really get it. I'm not going to pretend to. I just know I'm a fan. And what do you think? Good? Bad? We'll move on. All right, how about an Air Max 1 Air Max Day? All right, I don't like this shoe. I'm not gonna be honest with you. I have it in the collection because I bought it on release, not knowing how shitty they were. But here's my honest opinion on this. This is just a poor representation of what the Air Max 1 OG should be. What's the problem with it? Well, it has the 2.0 horrible sole on it. That's blasphemy to this. It says 326 on the tongue tag. If you have this shoe and love it too, by the way, fast forward through this, not for you. But yeah, they say 326 on the tongue tag. They have a check that is essentially ironed on vinyl. The upper is not suede. It is a rubber material. All in all, a thumb and a half down, we'll put it. They could be a little worse, I guess. The back looks good, right? Like I said, I bought them not really knowing what the situation was on them. If I could go back, I would buy anything else on earth, almost anything. Maybe just had the money. Anyway, they're here. They're not going anywhere because they're not worth anything, but don't buy this. Buy the OG Anniversary, which has the correct sole, which has the correct materials. It's gonna cost you more, but at the end of the day, it's the shoe you deserve as a Vintage Kicks Gallery fan. All right, guys, that's gonna do it for this part two, and join us next week for part three, and hopefully within a year or so, we'll get through all this. All right, I'll see you later. Oh, by the way, like and subscribe and share, please. We need more subs. Share this thing. You know, shout at the top of your rooftop. Do anything. Text a friend. But share. And then like. But subscribe first. All right, thanks. See you next time.